Jeremiah chapter 1. The words of Jeremiah the son of Hilkiah of the priest. We learn that Jeremiah is a Levite. He is a priest. All priests are Levites, but not all Levites are priests. He is a priest. In this book, he is a prophet rather than the priestly function. Of the priests that were at Antioch. Now, Antioch is his hometown. Later on, we will see that they will reject him, as Jesus' hometown had rejected him. It's a fact of a Christian that your hometown, your family, will reject your work, your being, your doing, because they know who you are. And most likely, into any call of a ministry, God will move you away. I thought that I could stay in my hometown and beat the fact, but no. I had to be called away in the land of Benjamin. So we learned much from Jeremiah that he's living in the land of Benjamin because the priests did not have an inheritance. They were given land amongst the tribes of Israel, the 12 tribes. Their inheritance, the Bible says, was God. So they did not get a piece of land. They were given land in the 12 tribes to settle in. But they didn't have a designed specific piece of lot as the 12 tribes got. So in Antioch, it is 3 miles northeast of Jerusalem. So he's not far from the temple. To whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, and he is the last good king of Judah. He is the one that found the word, the law of God in the temple. He's the one that searched out God to find out, hey, there's wrath coming. What do I need to do to get right? He pleased God. The son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year, 13 in the Bible is rebellion. Rebellion number amongst a good king. In a book that they will end up in Babylon. 13th year of his reign. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah. Unto the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah. Unto the carrying away of Jerusalem, captive in the 5th month. This book will start off with three verses telling you that the book will end up in captivity. The word of the Lord came unto me saying, before I formed thee in the belly, God is the author, God is the creator of life. Of a man and a woman coming together. I'd like to know what you put the abortion issue. That life is not a mistake. Children are the heritage of the Lord, the Bible said. I knew thee. The foreknowledge of God. He knew Jeremiah before he was even conceived. So the Bible says about Pharaoh, for this reason I raised you up. What is that? That God could purposely destroy Pharaoh? No, God knew what Pharaoh's actions would be. He knew Pharaoh would never repent. He knew Pharaoh would never get right. He knew Pharaoh was the perfect man at the perfect time to say, you know what? Upon him will I put my judgment. Listen, Moses warned him time after time after time. At least 11 times Moses warned him before each judgment. And God knew he would never get right. He knew Pilate would be the exact man for the job. It's not like Pilate never had a chance. It's like Pharaoh never had a chance. The free will of man that God gives man, but God already knows what you're going to choose. He knew Jeremiah would do right. He will know that Jeremiah one day said, Lord, I've had it talk about you. I've had it talking about your words. I'm going to quit. And God's like, no, you won't. I'll just wait. That word will get so hot in your mouth, you won't shut up. I'll just wait. You just keep on acting like a little baby. I'll take care of you. God knows. But God never forces us. He gives you a choice. You can do right or you can sin. That's your choice. That's the only two choices you've got. Now, if you do right, that's pleasing to God. You get rewarded. If you do wrong, you get evil for sinning. Now, God gives you that choice, but God already knows which choice you're going to make in your life. That you already, He already knows already what you're going to choose before you choose it. But He doesn't force you. He can put somebody in a church on the base on what He already knows that guy. He can put that guy in that church to destroy that church. Because He knows he'll choose to sin. Or He can choose somebody to put you in a church that's going to do right because He already knows what you're going to choose of the two decisions that you have. Jeremiah wants to do right. God already knew it. Pharaoh would never do right. God knew it. But He never forces. He never forces Jeremiah to do right. Jeremiah backs out. Lord said, okay, fine. I knew thee. Before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified. That means to set apart. To be used for God. There are people out there who are not sanctified. They are never and will never be used of God. They will be a child of the devil. There are Christians who get saved. Some are not sanctified. Some will not be used of God because they choose not to be. Sanctified is when you set apart for God's service. And I ordain thee a prophet unto the nations. Isaiah 49:1. Not just Jerusalem, not just Judah, not just to the Israelites, but to the nations we'll see. And then Jeremiah does a Moses. Then said, I, O Lord, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. Every man that is called into the Bible, he doesn't want it. He looks for excuses. Both Moses and Jeremiah, oh man, you want me to do all this work? Oh Lord, please find somebody else better. But the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child. Oh, He rebukes him like He rebuked Moses. Just don't say it. Jeremiah is going up against the elders. Here's this young man. He's going to go up to the old men, and he's going to rebuke them in Jewish in the law. That's a violation. What's his name? Elihu in the book of Job. 37 chapters, 38 chapters. He sat there and listened to the four of them speak. And then when he finally quit speaking, he says, listen, I'm younger than you guys. You are older than I. He says, I waited for you to speak. I heard your speech. Now that you're done, out of respect, I'm younger than you. Let me speak. For thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee. Oh, boy. All the places that are ordained, a divine guidance of God. And Jeremiah goes all the way to the river Euphrates. No, take that back. Jeremiah will be going to all places. He'll be taken down to Egypt by force. Not sure if he's the one that has the girdle that goes to Euphrates or not. And whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Look at that. You don't even have preachers that do that today. You don't even have Sunday school teachers that do that. They bring in Patch the Pirate. They bring in a little nice little book. They don't use the Bible. Bible says, go ye in all the world, preach the gospel. They use Sunday school material. They don't use the Bible. Be not afraid of their faces. For I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. You know, even I've been guilty of this sin. You look upon somebody, you think he's some big old brute. And usually the big old brutes, you know, that guy who looks like a biker kind of guy will kill you with his six-blade knife and have you for dinner. Usually they're the sweetest and nicest people. It's that little old lady that will cuss you out. And we ought not to do that. When we judge people by their appearance, that is a sin, the Bible says. We ought not to be afraid because of what they look like. Appearances are deceiving. When Samuel goes to Jesse, oh, look at his firstborn son. God's like, that's not, stop looking about it. Remember Samuel, we picked King Saul about why and how he looked, and that didn't work. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth, inspiration. Well, man wrote the Bible. Yeah, but God told Jeremiah, what you write and what you speak, I have breathed. I have sealed with the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 6:7, Ezekiel 3:2. See, I have this day set thee over the nations. That confirms verse 5. And over the kingdoms. Now, he says, I will put my words in thy mouth. That answers verse 6. I cannot speak. Okay? You can't speak. I'm going to make you speak. I am going to give you the ability to speak. I know you can't do it, Jeremiah. That's why I'm going to help you. And watch what he does. And by the way, verse 10 is the Roman Catholic application to the Pope. Over kingdoms to root out. To pull the roots out of the ground. Death. You pull a plant out by the roots and throw it on the ground, it's going to die. To pull down. And to destroy. These are the nations he's dealing with. To throw down, to build, well, that's the help that's coming, that's to get going, and to plant. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. There's a time. What God's telling Jeremiah is judgment is coming. Yeah, but there's a build and there's a plant. There's not going to be an utter destruction like the worldwide flood. And yet with the worldwide flood, there was a man to build and to plant the human race. Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou? And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Number 17:8. A rod is, according to Proverbs, the means of correcting a child. The almond tree is the same tree that Aaron's rod was. For it said it brought forth life and had almonds. The almond tree in the last chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes speaks of an old age. It has white flowers. An old man has white hair. He says, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then said the Lord unto me, Thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my word to perform it. The word of God as a rod. Life from a dead stick. God is going to spank these nations. God is going to spank Judah. They've done wrong, and they need correcting. And the word of the Lord came unto me the second time, saying, What seest thou? And I said, I see a seething pot. That's a pot, big pot used for boiling. You put all kinds of bones, meat bones on it, and you just cook it up till all the meat is broken off the bones. And the face thereof is toward the north. Then the Lord said unto me, Out of the north an evil shall break forth upon all the inhabitants of the land. What lands he's in? He's in Benjamin. He's in Judah. That seething pot would be Babylon. For lo, I will call all the families of the kingdom of the north, saith the Lord. They shall come, and they shall set every one his throne at the entering of the gates of Jerusalem. Specific place. And against all the walls thereof round about. And against all the cities of Judah. Not just Jerusalem, but Judah. Now, difficult times calls for a difficult saint. Difficult times calls for a dedicated saint. There are hard times coming. And God calls a faithful man. He won't use a man that is lukewarm. Not this time. Now Jeremiah is about 100 years after Isaiah. Plus or minus. Jeremiah means God will cast out. So every time Jeremiah is going to meet with these people, his very name tells the people, I'm going to cast you out. And he tells Jeremiah not to fear. The beat fear is to remember God is with you. Now we're going to get into the spiritual corruption. And I, God, was speaking, will utterly utter my judgments against them, the people of Jerusalem and Judah, touching all their wickedness. Who have forsaken me. America better take note to Jeremiah. America has forsaken God. And have burned incense unto other gods. The Roman Catholic Church. And the New Age movement. Is against God. And worship the works of their own hands. Made in America. Made in China. Look what I did. Look at the achievements I got. And these are idols. So the spiritual condition of Judah and Jerusalem is corruption. Thou therefore gird up thy loins. I'm talking to Jeremiah now. Get dressed. Arise. Don't sit down. Don't be a couch potato. And speak unto them all that I command thee. That's a given to all preachers, all evangelists, all men that preach the Bible. And yet, very few hold to this verse. There is much in the Bible that God has commanded us to speak that we don't need to go off into other stupid things and worldly things. Nowhere does God say if you give him $100, he'll give you $100,000. Nowhere does it say that if a man lays hands on somebody today and they got healing, and if it don't work, you don't have enough faith. Nowhere does it say, as a matter of fact, in the book of Jeremiah, we're going to learn otherwise, that a church should have a Christmas tree and celebrate the pagan holidays. Be not dismayed at their faces. Again, this is the second time. Lest I confound thee before them. Uh-oh. If you don't do what I tell you to do, Jeremiah, and you show fear, I'm going to give you a licking right in front of them. For behold, I have made thee this day a defense city. Jeremiah is likened to a city. And an iron pillar. That's a strong metal pillar. Holds up the roof. Holds up a second story. And brazen, that's brass walls. Against the whole land. Now, against. The type of Christ. God is not for the whole land. We just read their sins. So God is against the land of Jerusalem, the land of Judah, because of their sins. Jeremiah is to be against Jerusalem and Judah because of their sins. You scream and all that. You're yelling at us. Blah, blah, blah. You're against us. Thank you very much. I am Bible proved by your own word. Against the kings of Judah. Now we already saw Josiah is one and the last good king. The next kings, the final kings, they do evil. Don't take their side. He's against the rulers. This whole land is turned against God. They will not allow his word in the schools. They will not allow his word in the courtroom. They will not allow his Ten Commandments to be put into the prisons or into the courts. They don't want God, so we are to be against the land, not waving the flag. And when our president is against the Christians, and he's against, I'm not just talking about one specific man, I'm talking about any president that's against the Bible, against the Christians, against the word and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are to be against him. Kings of Judah, that would be rulers of Judah. Against the princes thereof. That's the ones under the king. To us, that would be the senators, the House of Representatives. Against the priest. What was Jeremiah in verse 1? His own family. If they're against God, the Bible says you are to be against them. And if you are not, you are the sinner. And don't be surprised if God destroys, that you may give him your full love. The priests, the kings, the land are going to die or end up in Babylon. Thereof. And against the people, the Jews of the land. Anybody who rejected Jesus when he was on this earthly ministry, he just kept on going. He only stopped for those that called out to him. How many lepers did he walk by? How many blind people did he go past? How many deaf people did he avoid because they never reached out to him? They did not have the faith that he could heal them or even care for him to come into their life. Very much. And they, the land, the kings, the princes, the priests, the people, your family, the priests, they shall fight against thee. You're against them, they're going to be against you. Don't you take the middle ground. You take the high ground, you put your armor on, and you take the battle. Plain and simple. This is the first chapter of a book that is going to end up in Babylon because they would not do right. Death and destruction. This book ends with the book of Lamentations. The destruction, the description of the land because of sin. And if you don't do what God tells you to do as a Christian, your life as a Christian will end up as a lamentation instead of a glorification. They shall fight against thee, but they shall not prevail against thee. And you can just imagine Jeremiah. I mean, God tells him, don't fear. You're going to be against me, but listen. I'll take care of you, Jeremiah. I'll take care of you. They shall not prevail against thee. They're not going to win. They're going to lose. And we'll see a remarkable thing with Jeremiah. The enemy is going to come up to Jeremiah and is going to say, because of this, because of these sins, have we come into this area. Your God has sent us here to destroy this nation. Now, Jeremiah, I'll give you two things. What? You can go with me to Babylon, I'll take care of you, and we'll give you right. Or you go back to the land, we're going to leave some people here, you stay in your homeland, and thank you for being faithful to God. And that's a heathen. By the way, Jeremiah, he does not ever get a convert. Jeremiah has no spiritual notches on his spiritual belt on how many people he got saved. He preached the word, and he preached it faithfully, and he preached it right, and God was joyful with him, even though he didn't get no results, even though the city did not get right, even though the people ended up in captivity. He did what God told him to do in a complete failure in today's ministry standards. Jeremiah did right. And all the people in Jeremiah's time, in his ministry, and in his prophet, all those that go off in the lake of fire will stand at the great white throne judgment as a Jeremiah witnesses to them, I told you, and you wouldn't get right. Jeremiah will have no blood on his fingers for those that end up in hell. And yet, he had not one convert. He is not a failure. Because you know what success is? When you hear God tell you at the judgment. Now Jeremiah will not be at the great. Jeremiah will not be at the judgment seat of Christ. He'll be at the great white throne judgment with his name in the book of life. He will go through. Success is when God tells you, "Well done." That's success. That is success. You get a man that is in the pulpit of a church, he may have only five families. But man, he loves the Lord. He studies the word. He tries to group, get those people to learn and do what they're supposed to. In the area where he lives, he tries to witness, tries to get people saved. He goes to the hospital. He visits the people. And he does. He's a minister to the people in the name of God. And anybody else will look at him, you know, he's probably got a used car that breaks down. And his family, you know, he's got time for his family, but there's more time to the people of the church. And man, he's just making it, and he's having a hard time. And to the world, that would be a failure. And God saying, wait a minute, that's the faithful one. That's the faithful one. Instead of having people minister you as a pastor, are you ministering to the people? That's the success in the ministry. Are you praying for the people in your church? You know, when you go through 52 chapters of Jeremiah, he is weeping for the people. He is caring for the people. He is having a conflict with his to do right because the people are not doing right. He's having a one-on-one conversation with God about the people because he cares. Because he is going to speak everything that God tells him not to be. No, come on, get right. Please, get right. Do what God's telling you. God is warning you. He's telling you through me, get right. And he weeps in tears. And he's a success. And they're not going to prevail against you. You do what God tells you to do, the ministry that God has given you to do, and don't seek for results. And just do what God told you to do. Just do what God has told you to do. Just do what God has told you to do. Just do what God has told you to do. Get rid of the programs. Get rid of the toys. Get rid of the garbage. And get the word and preach the word like God has told you. You may not get results, but God has called you to do something that other people don't do, is preach the word. That's not being done today. And I am quite shocked to be in places where I would never thought what is going on that is going on. For I, God, am with thee. That is God's presence. God is walking and talking with Jeremiah. That's interesting. For God to come out and say, I am with you. I'm going to stay with you. As long as you stay faithful, I am with you. There's a lot of men who have done things for God, and God is not with them because the things they chose to do, the shortcuts they picking, the results of to get the world, to go with the world, to go with the flow, and God is okay. I gotta leave. Jeremiah preaches the word, and that's all he does, and God is with him. He preaches the word to men. He preaches the word to women. He preaches the word to children. He preaches the word to Gentiles. He preaches the word to the people. And nothing else. There's no gizmos. There's no programs. There's no fooling around. It is the word. With a nation that's going to fall and fail before God. It is the word. It's the priests. It's the Levites that have got the programs and the junk and the world. And they're the ones that fall and die and end up in Babylon, defeated, saith the Lord, to deliver thee. That's a promise. That's a promise. He has God's presence, and he has God's promise. In opening chapter 1 of Jeremiah is, Jeremiah, I am with you. I've given you a promise. Fight. Get up and fight. I've called you to be a prophet rather than a priest. The spiritual condition of the people is corruption. And guess what? Judgment is coming. And you have not seen the end of it at all. Now, we've read Jeremiah. I hope you read Jeremiah. They're not going to treat Jeremiah nice. They are going to hate Jeremiah. They're going to want to get rid of him. They're going to want to kill him. They're going to take his words and they're going to burn them. And he has no friends of the world. He has two friends in the book of Jeremiah. A eunuch and I can't think of the other guy's name right now. We'll come up. That's it. And God makes a promise to those two men. So those two men are serving and loving God. But that's it. He's not well liked. When you got a nation that is against and left God, they're not going to like you. They even may try to sign a petition to get rid of you. They may even call the police to get rid of you. They may even take you to court to get rid of you. They may do all kinds of things to get rid of you. And the Bible says, all they that live godly shall suffer persecution. If you're well liked as a man of God, if you're well liked as a preacher, if you're well liked as a Christian, you fail. If you are given the keys to a city, you fail. They take Jeremiah and put him in a dungeon and throw the keys away. Jeremiah is called to fight. And the condition that Jeremiah is in is the same condition that America is in today. We don't need wimps. We don't need couch potatoes. We need soldiers armed with the armor of God, with the word of God that's a sword. And listen, go out there in love and tears and tell people about the coming judgment. Tell people about hell. Tell people about a loving God. Tell people what... Oh, you mean be a prophet. See, I'm a prophet. I can tell you where you're going to go when you die. You say, where's that? It's either heaven or hell. Heaven is by the Lord Jesus Christ. Hell is by anything else but. And if you go to hell, there's damnation, there's tribulation, there's troubles, there's problems, there's torments for all eternity. If you go to heaven, you have an opportunity to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, do right, and be pleasing to him and take a butt licking from the world like Jeremiah is going to get. And not everybody's going to love you, and not all your riches are going to be found in your wallet, and not every bill is going to be paid, not everything's going to be wonderful, and life is not going to be hunky-dory if you're going to be a Christian for the Lord Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, things may even be even worse. But when you stand before the Lord Jesus Christ and have those holy hands, I mean holy H-O-L-Y and holy W-H-O-L-L-Y, to be taking a crown and put on your head to have well done, thou good and faithful service above all things of success. Imagine have God incarnate in the flesh with a holy body who died for me to put a crown upon my head because all I did was listen to him. And try to keep my life unsoiled and unspotted of the world. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, that is Jeremiah that I bring before you. He's a remarkable man. He's remarkable because God is with him and God's going to deliver him. And no matter what they do or try to do to him or against him, he remains faithful to the end.